can the clock of old age be stopped?
From the data, it appears that human beings have genetically programmed a lifespan. Okay. Now, there are people who will disagree with me, but I would say somewhere between 80 to 120 years. I do not, there are some people who think that we will live much longer, but I think that most of us are interested in living healthier, okay, but not necessarily longer. But I think that really there's a limit to what you can do with the species, with man as such. I think that man has a definite lifespan, and that lifespan is probably in the 80 to 120 year range.
One of the heaviest backers of age research is millionaire Paul Glenn. He made his fortune in the commodities market, and he's spending much of that fortune in pursuit of the most basic commodity of all, long life.
After I'd made some money in Wall Street, it occurred to me that time was more precious than money. That is what I really lacked. From that time on, I began to seriously look into the question of whether or not we could extend the human lifespan in time to keep me alive longer, too. I'm a capitalist, and we believe in exchanging value for value. That is why I'm very happy to give money to scientists to study aging, and in return, I hope that they'll be able to lengthen my lifespan.
Yes, what kind of results are you looking for? I mean, do you have a vision of the fountain of youth, or what?
I hope to live significantly beyond 100 years. I would say at least to 110 or 120. At this time, we can't say really what is the maximum potential human lifespan.
Dirk Pearson and his partner, Sandy Shikoshis, are highly qualified biochemists and a very odd couple indeed. They're using their own bodies as laboratories, taking massive daily doses of what are called antioxidants. Antioxidants, roughly speaking, mean vitamins E and C, and the belief is that massive doses can offset the cell damage that leads to the body's decay. Within the network of the body, this is what happens. Each cell is bordered by its membrane. One of the functions of the cell is to generate energy. When that happens, hydrogen is created, which reacts with oxygen to produce water. But sometimes one of the oxygen molecules escapes into the nearest membrane, where it reacts with fat to form what's called a free radical. The radical runs wild and can cause damage to anything in its path, including the genetic blueprint which governs the health of the cell. But antioxidant vitamins, particularly vitamin E, can neutralize the damage and prevent the free radical escaping from the cell and running wild. So Dirk and Sandy are seeking to quench free radical damage with mega doses of antioxidant vitamins.
How do you feel yourselves after having taken so much of stuff like this for so long?
We feel very good, actually. Our physiological condition is probably considerably better than it should be. For example, our vascular system elasticity is typical for what you would find in a highly physically trained teenage athlete.
I think that in terms of the musculature that we have, we're in much better condition than most of the people our age.
Show them your muscles there, Sandy.
Yeah.
I might add that
that was a
byproduct of trying to make her broken foot heal faster. She broke her foot at the Gordon Research Conference on
her
the
foot.
Biology of aging.
Yeah.
Right. She jumped up in the air and landed in an untenable position and broke her foot. So we altered her neuroendocrine system to look like a teenager's, because, of course, a teenager heals much faster than somebody who's middle-aged. We're both 36.
But since you are human laboratories, guinea pigs, aren't you concerned that there could well be side effects that you do not know about, dangers you cannot detect in yourselves?
Yes, indeed. That's why we have hundreds and hundreds of these clinical tests performed to monitor particularly our blood, kidney, and liver function, though other things are tested as well.
But can there be adequate tests for what you're doing, since you're doing something that nobody has done to this extent before?
Well, remember, the clinical tests are for pathological, that is, damaging type reactions. The tests that are able to tell us that, in fact, yes, we are younger or we have an improved physiology, these are in a relatively crude state of development. There aren't too many tests that are capable of giving this information, but there's a lot of tests that any standard hospital has for measuring damage-type mechanisms, and this is what we look for.
In the 10 years since they started, Dirk and Sandy have undergone regular checkups at medical centers in Los Angeles. Routine tests that can measure the health of their vital organs. They themselves confidently expect to live vigorous lives well beyond 100 years. But all the machines can tell them is whether they're in danger of living a lot less.
Anybody who makes a human guinea pig out of themselves is a damn fool if they don't adequately test themselves, because they might end up shortening their life rather than increasing it. It's essential that they look for toxic effects if they're going to be taking mega doses of a great many different things.
What would you say to people listening to you now who'd say you must be damn fools anyway to be taking this kind of chance in so many uncertain areas of science?
Well, we have probably studied the area a great deal more thoroughly than they.
It's a lot less uncertain for us than
for
it
us
is
than for them,
non-specialists.
Right. I can see that a doctor, for example, who has not studied toxicology and aging mechanisms might very well say, well, you're damn fools even taking the test. Well, that's his opinion, but it is an uninformed opinion. A doctor is a craftsman, a technician. He is not a biochemist.
In the University of Nebraska, a similar diet of antioxidants has worked for white mice, extending their lifespan by up to 20%. If it could work for human beings, that would correspond to an extra 5 to 10 years. In California, brown mice are competing with their white Nebraska counterparts to extend the frontiers of age research. To boost the body's immune mechanism and also the DNA repair system, which controls how we react to invading organisms that can damage us.
With age, your DNA repair deteriorates. It develops breaks and nicks and other defects, and an enzyme system exists which goes along and kind of reads out these defects and stitches them up and repairs them in other ways. This is an important aspect of aging, because if you compare the DNA repair capacity between different animals, from shrew to rabbit to horse to elephant to man, you find that the DNA repair capacity is best in the longest lived species. Man is better than the elephant, which is better than the horse, better than the dog, better than the shrew. DNA repair capacity is proportional to maximum lifespan. One can hope that in the not too distant future, we or others would be able to, for example, increase the rate of DNA repair in the body as a whole. And this would be a more fundamental, general way of retarding the aging rate and increasing maximum lifespan. This is still in the future, but probably not in the very distant future.
The results of age research are eagerly awaited, not just by medical science. Economically and politically, old age is an urgent challenge. In 1945, for every one American living on a pension with Social Security, there were 35 active wage earners. In 1980, for every pensioner, there are just 4 wage earners. By the year 2000, there will only be 2. These are American figures, but the rest of the developed world shows the same trend, deeply disturbing for governments everywhere. What's happening, say the sociologists, is a new phenomenon, a new ism called ageism. By the year 2000, there will be twice as many people in the world over the age of 60 as there were 10 years ago, and twice as many over the age of 80. In America, the Veterans Administration, concerned at the demands that too many senile old soldiers will make on the public purse, is sponsoring age research. One project in particular is close to success. So it's the thymus gland and the lymphocytes it helps to produce that Dr. Marguerite Kay is studying for the Veterans Administration in Los Angeles. What Dr. Kay is trying to do in her experiments with mice is to keep the thymus active even in old age.
We gave the mice new stem cells, which are the cells in the bone marrow that then move into the thymus and other organs. We gave them some pieces of thymus. We gave them thymic transplants. And these mice lived 25% longer, and when a viral infection swept the animal colony, rather nasty virus, these mice survived the infection, whereas other older mice died. The other way we've been able to do this is with some synthetic chemicals. We have seen a prolongation in lifespan, and we have seen an increase in immune function in older animals to the level of that of younger animals.
How long is it likely to be before you apply the techniques that you've been using on the mice to people?
That is a difficult question because it's dependent on many drug committees and research committees. The technology should work when translated directly from mouse. It should be able to work directly in human beings with no difficulty. Meeting the necessary requirements, I would say, would take 5 to 10 years before we're able to have it in human beings. The end product is that people will be much healthier, that rather than spending all their time in the hospital, they'll spend their time out on the tennis courts or gardening or doing whatever. If one can, in fact, increase immune response, then people would be resistant to diseases like cancer, infections, and presumably also things like heart disease, because the immune system plays an active role, or at least evidence is beginning to emerge, in things like atherosclerosis. So our ultimate goal is obviously to have people who live perfectly healthily and then one day just suddenly die. And what age that would be could be 80 years old, could be 100 years old, but somewhere around there.
But while American scientists are working hard to prolong the lifespan, many of their fellow citizens seem determined to cut it short. No thymus transplant can compensate for a daily diet of fat-filled, sugar-laden junk. And that's where this man comes in. His name is Nathan Pritikin. At the center he runs in Santa Monica, junk food is the enemy and long life the ambition. The program is founded on the belief that age-related illnesses, like heart disease, diabetes, hardening of the arteries, can not only be prevented, but actually reversed by rigorous exercise and a rigorous, low-fat, low-cholesterol diet. The Pritikin way of life has already been commended by the American Airline Pilots Association and by some nutritionists. The diet is drawn from more primitive societies with much lower rates of heart disease and certain kinds of cancer. In the Nathan Pritikin system, there are 7 commandments. Thou shalt not smoke, nor eat fats, sugar, salt, or foods with cholesterol. Neither shalt thou drink coffee or tea. Alcohol is too disastrous to be even mentioned in the list. It's a high carbohydrate diet rich in fiber, with health rather than loss of weight as its prime objective.
If you don't live longer, you're going to live better. You're going to live without the fear of diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and so on. And countries that follow this kind of diet, glaucoma, cataract, are unknown. And so are the many other diseases that are the principal cause of death in countries like the United States.
Why do people come to you?
They many come out of desperation because they've reached the limits of conventional medical care. Others come just to prevent disease, who have no obvious symptoms.
Are you offering them longevity? That's the name of the center.
Yes, we're offering them actually quality of life. Hopefully, people will be able to live much longer than they're living now, but live without fear of the problems of disease.
But if there is controversy about what is a proper diet, isn't $5,000 an awful lot of money to pay on the assumption that you've got the right answer?
Well, it depends on how much your life is worth to you. It depends on how much it's worth you to avoid heart disease. Or if you have heart disease, to be able to alleviate it so you don't have the symptoms. People have spent $20,000 with coronary bypass surgery that neither cures the problem or even helps it. They may get some temporary relief from angina, but 20% of all bypasses close in the first 12 months anyway. $5,000 is a cheap price to pay.
Why do so many doctors view what you do with suspicion? We've been talking to people who say that their doctors didn't want to know they were coming here, or indeed made it difficult for their medical records to be sent on to you. Why do they take that view?
Doctors are very cautious about any group that tells you you can get better with a diet. There are hundreds of diets in the country, and most of them are strictly for weight reduction. They have no therapeutic properties. And you can't blame a doctor for being suspicious of a diet. Until they investigate what we're doing, I don't blame them for being suspicious.
So the Longevity Center has not yet won unanimous approval from the medical world. But provided that its clients can resist the worst temptations when they leave, it's a practical contribution to the battle between American science and old age. Not many of us will retain the energy of Nathan Pritikin's star pupil, 90-year-old Eula Weaver, who still jogs several miles a day. But while age research goes on, there's hope.
What kind of shape were you in when you first came to see Nathan Pritikin? What did he do for you?
I was really bad sick, and I was taking 15 to 18 pills every 24 hours. And he told me I didn't have to take that if I would join his way of eating and go out and go to jogging. And I told him that my neighbors would say that the old lady had lost a screw if I went out and went to jogging. And he said, don't make any difference what they say. He said, you do as I say and you'll be a well woman.
And is that the way it turned out?
And so help me God, he saved my life.